comparison of the Garmin GPS Map 64ST and the GPS Map 62ST units, which are nearly identical, with the 64ST being the most recent one and offering a few features that the 62ST does not. In my overview, I will state my opinion on what I think in terms of value between the two, considering that at the time of this review, you can get a brand new 62ST unit for about $250, which is effectively half the price of the 64ST. I'd like to do a basic hardware comparison between the two based on manufacturer-provided specifications. Both of these units, as mentioned earlier, are nearly identical. They both sport a 2.6-inch 65,000 color TFT sunlight readable display, which I found on both to be nearly identical, with the exception that the newer 64ST unit seems to have a little bit more of a cooler color shade, kind of a bluish hue on the screen, and slightly blurrier than the 62ST, which seems to have the screen calibrated a little bit warmer. I found that that made this one have better contrast on the maps and the map shading feature looked a little bit more natural. Other than that, they're pretty much identical, and as far as brightness goes and the reflective sunlight readable characteristic of them, they're both identical. I did not see any differences between the two when the backlight was off and they were in direct sunlight. Physically, they're exactly the same. Only difference you'll notice is just the label on the top. They seem to have changed the font a little bit. So you can see on the newer units, the GPS map name is completely in capitalized and more of like a squarish font. On the older units, it was only capitalized for the word GPS, and the model number was in standard font, whereas here you can see it's actually a little bit more bold. Other than that, once again, completely identical all the way down to the backing. So they both weigh exactly the same. I believe it's somewhere in the vicinity of 9.2 ounces. They are a little bit on the heavier side, but they feel quite nice on the hand. So seeing how those are identical on both, I'm not going to spend too much time talking about the button layout and other things that are obviously standouts as being identical. Software versions, right out of the box, I believe this one had software version 2.8. This one came with software version 5.4. Latest as of this recording, end of August, this one is at 3.10, and this one is at 5.8, I believe, or 5.6. We'll find out when I switch them on. And without further ado, I will switch them on now. I'll have to apologize in advance. I left the batteries elsewhere, and this one has low batteries, but it can still operate, just not at the full brightness setting, which should not be a problem for this demonstration. One thing you'll notice is this unit booted up a little bit faster than this one. I believe that's because this one, in addition to the 100K topo mat that's preloaded, which is preloaded on this one as well, it also has 250,000 geocaches that are preloaded. And every time you boot up, it has to load that into memory. So That's my explanation. It could be something else, but I think it sounds good. Okay, moving on. You can actually see a little bit of the difference in the screen calibration. As you can see, this one is a little bit on the cooler side, and it seems to be more bluish, while this one is warmer, and the colors look a little bit more natural. I mean, this is one of those things that could be a preference. Somebody might actually like the bluer hues a little bit better, but I did find that this one seemed to be slightly blurrier due to those hues, and the contrast in, especially on the shading on the map, wasn't as good as this one. So that's one thing to take into consideration. It might actually be a different manufacturer for the screen. They look identical, but you never know in the electronics industries. Menus on both are nearly identical. You get a little bit more options in this one. If I go back to the map and I hit the menu button, you'll notice that on this one you've got the geocache filter option right on the menu. This is not available on this one, and I think Garmin did that because of the built-in 250,000 geocaches on this one. Now, keep in mind, I did load a few geocaches for my local area into this unit, and I still don't get that option. So this must be based on the fact that they, you know, they have those preloaded. Now, that option is available if you go to the geocaches menu or option, and then just hit menu, and you'll see that you've got an apply filter option. So you don't really lose the functionality, you just don't have it readily available right on the map. Now I have a set of custom maps loaded. I found that the Topo 100K map is slightly inaccurate when it comes to the road systems, at least here in Washington State. I live in the Puget Sound area. And although both have those inaccuracies, I found that the older version on the 62ST is also missing quite a few roads that were built in the last 5 years or so. And it also has some discrepancies in some of the roads. For instance, there's a community that I drive to visit family, and a road that on this one shows as essentially going through to the next block, and this one does not show so, and this one is correct. So a couple of discrepancies there. This is map Topo 100K map version 4. This is version 5 on the newer unit. For some reason, you cannot, regardless of when you purchase the 62SD, you cannot upgrade the map to version 5 directly on the unit. You would have to purchase a new one and just put it on an SD card or something along those lines. So something to keep in consideration. Now, I'll straight up give my opinion. I don't think the Topo 100K map is all that great. In fact, if you were to find the S version of either one of these units for a better price, I would opt for that and just purchase a Topo 24K map for your area, or simply download one of the free ones, which is what I've done. I will show you that real quick, just so that you know which one I'm using. I've got it loaded on both, and it's for the local area, so... So I've got the base map enabled on both, which comes in the Garmin units. I disabled the Topo 100K on both units, and I've got this Washington Topo map, which is a 24K map. And that's... So there's the information in case you felt like... I guess that's actually the website for the company that makes the software used to build this map, so not really it. but at some point during the video, I will place the information either at the bottom of the screen or it'll be in the information section for the video on YouTube, so you know where to find the map. Okay, so moving on, I wanted to show you the main menu on both units, pretty much identical. You'll notice a icon difference here with the geocaches section. I guess Garmin is moving towards using this icon type. This would be an older one, even though the software version of this is updated. But if I scroll down, and they're both set to the recreational profile, by the way, you'll notice that the options are pretty much identical. Nothing new to report. Satellites, and that's it. Now, from the menu, let's move on to the satellite section, which will show you the satellites that the GPS units are locked onto. You'll notice a difference right away. As you can see here on the bottom portion, we've got the area dedicated for displaying the signal strength for GLONASS satellites, which are the satellites deployed by Russia. 62ST does not support GLONASS, so you only get the GPS satellites that are provided by the US. Things that I found, I am indoors right now. As you can see, I get signal for both. However, if I were to move the GPS unit even just a few feet farther in away from the windows, I will lose GPS signal on this unit. On this unit, it seems to lock onto GPS signals a little bit better. Even when I set it only to GPS mode and not GPS plus GLONASS. So the GLONASS functionality on this definitely adds to the ability to lock into a signal quicker, but I believe this unit is optimized a little bit better in general. So that's another thing to consider. Even though you see the signals here are pretty much the same on the GPS, as I mentioned, if I were to move this unit a few feet farther into my apartment, I will lose signal on this one almost immediately. Outdoors, this one definitely with the GPS plus GLONASS enabled, plus WAS, I get a fairly accurate signal within just a few feet, maybe 2 or 3 meters. On this one, it gets pretty close, but it's definitely not as accurate to the point as this one is. I mean, occasionally you will be right on the spot, right on the money, but overall, I believe this one to be much more accurate when all of the different options are enabled. I will say this unit drains batteries a lot quicker than this one. This one from the factory is rated at up to 20 hours of use, this one 16, but I think this one is probably at least a factor of half the battery life of this one, all things considered. Part of that could be just the additional GPS types signal functionality, but part of it could be something else that I'm about to discuss, which has to do with overall performance. So let's move out. So let's move into the map and I will show you something else. So the units look pretty much identical in terms of the map and map performance. But one thing you will notice right away, let's see that I were to zoom out a few levels up, so 2.8, see how quickly that loaded. Let's do two more to 2 miles, okay. And this is actually rendering right now the topo map, the shaded relief, as well as waypoints and a few other things. This one, let's zoom out real quick and so that took a little bit longer. For that specific zoom level, it doesn't seem like the difference is huge. At certain zoom levels though, once this one starts going into the realm of 3 to 4 seconds to render, this one will take effectively twice as long. So Anytime I counted 4 seconds on this one, this would take about 7 to 8 seconds. If this one took 5 to 6 seconds, this one would take about 12. In some occasions, this one even took as far as anywhere from 16 to 18 seconds to render a few screens. So definitely the 64SD unit seems to be the faster model. Specs for the insides of this unit are never actually revealed, with the exception of the available memory for storing data. So it's hard to say if this is a product of newer hardware or if it's a product of software optimizations. I would probably say it's a combination of both, seeing how this unit is about 3 to 4 years old in the market, even though the one sitting here in front of me is actually brand new. And this one is only months old in the market. So they could have changed the specs a little bit, and the CPU and available RAM could actually be increased versus this one. All in all, I noticed about effectively twice the performance of this one. So that could also contribute to the battery issue that I was referring to. Now, whether or not that bothers you, I don't know. I decided to test them side by side on the field and see if in the real world, when I'm actually just hiking or biking, and this is usually zoomed in quite a bit, so you know I wouldn't have to be rendering a lot of things on the screen at the time. My opinion is it's not a huge deal. Some people might be into having the latest and greatest and knowing that what they have is actually faster than what's available out there, but if you're just getting these units for what they're intended to be used for, that may not be a huge issue. As you can see, if I scroll, you know, it takes about 1.5, maybe 2 seconds. This one renders fairly quick, it's almost instant. But then again, if you're moving around, hiking or biking, and the screen is actually scrolling with you, it is not going to make a difference. You know, the things that are being rendered towards the bottom of the screen, you're not going to get to them before they get rendered. So one of those other things. Features that this one has, other than GLONASS, that this one does not. This one supports Bluetooth for pairing with any smartphones. But one thing I need to mention is the notifications feature on this, that is Bluetooth-based, only works with iOS. I don't know if that's until they work out some bugs, or if it's going to be a permanent thing, but it will not work with Android devices. I have tested it. I have a Samsung Galaxy Note 3, which is actually what I'm recording this video with, and I have successfully paired this unit with the phone, and I cannot get the notifications to display on here. However, the other functionality that this has, which is based, as you can see, I just lost reception for no reason, and that's what I'm talking about. This one seems to lock into satellites a lot better, even indoors. Anyways, moving back, the Bluetooth functionality on this pairs successfully with my Android device, and it works with LiveTrack. In fact, it works fairly well. LiveTrack is a feature that Garmin provides where with the Garmin Connect app on your smartphone, you can actually share a link with specific people, email addresses, and they can, in real time, view the progress of your current trail or route. It's kind of a slightly scary Big Brother-ish type of functionality for those that are kind of paranoid. I think it's pretty cool. Obviously, you can't just have somebody randomly look at where you're at. They have to receive a specific link from you. And there are options so that the you can stop the track in real time, you can pause it. There's many things you can do, and it's not constantly tracking. It's only while the application is set up for the live track. So it's a cool feature. Other than playing around with it, I don't think I'm ever gonna use it. I don't really care for people knowing exactly where I'm at when I'm on a trail. I could see some future functionality for LiveTrack to be used for, I don't know, search and rescue and things of that nature, but for the time being and the kind of hiking and biking that I do, I don't need to be doing that. And the other thing is, because this is using your phone's data connection, that means your phone has to be within range, if it is within range, you could just use any of the, you know, hundreds of other applications available that can actually track your current progress as well. So having it directly from the GPS, I guess the only benefit is that you would be using the hardware GPS on this versus the one on your phone, which might help with battery life, but it's not really something that you know, you would be missing if you did not go with the newer unit. If this review sounds a little bit biased towards justifying the cost of, well, not the cost, but the cost savings of this unit over this one, is because I have spent enough time testing both to realize that if you are able to get this one at the current price of $250, by the way, I purchased this one specifically at Cabela's, but Amazon also has it at this price, then you would be getting about, I'd say, 90% of the features of this unit for half the cost. And that to me is, you know, a huge plus. Performance-wise, they're both great units. This one's going to be more accurate. This one will perform better in situations where you're probably surrounded by a lot of buildings. And I think outdoors with trees, they both perform fairly close. This one will always have an edge in terms of showing you the more accurate and exact location. As far as the altimeter goes on both units, they both seem to be off quite a bit. When you enable WAS and you're completely outdoors, then it gets a little bit closer. But I don't think this unit specifically will increase the accuracy of elevation based on the extra GLONASS support. So if you're going to be anal about your elevation accuracy, then you know, both units will perform the same, which is really not super great, but that's to be expected of consumer level GPS units. Hardware specs wise, this one comes with 8 gigabytes of built-in memory for map storage. Out of that, a big chunk is used. I believe about 3.5 gigs is available for extra map data, and it does support SD card inside. It's under the battery compartment. This one comes with 4 gigabytes, and about 0.5 gigabyte is available for storage. So with this one and the maps that I just preloaded, I had to put a 2 gigabyte micro SD card in it. Whereas this one, I could preload all that stuff without the need for a micro SD card. I think that also helps with the performance, because the built-in flash memory on this might actually be a little bit faster than the SD card that I put on this machine. But either way, I still think that hardware-wise, they must have made some improvements and optimized the software as well. So, again, all of the other functions, trip computer, elevation plot, everything is identical between the two units. You don't get any extra options on this one versus this one. Fonts vary a little bit, as you can see on this one, you know, a little bit more rounded. Whereas in this one, they're a little bit more like digital looking square font. So there's a few subtle changes in the user interface, but the options are all the same. If you go to, let's go back to the main menu. Get a setup. You will notice that you have one extra option here, which is Bluetooth. And that's for the obvious features that I stated earlier. Pairing was extremely easy. I did not have any issues pairing this with my smartphone. Currently I have the connection off, but it's as simple as turning that on and clicking pair mobile device. And then once your smartphone detects it, you just enter the PIN number that shows up over here and you're done. I did this several times. I actually unpaired and repaired and never ever had any issues. Notifications feature obviously only works with iOS, so it doesn't really matter if you have it at show or hide. If you're pairing this with an Android device, it will not work. That is about the only extra option on the 64XT versus the 62SD. Profiles are the same. You get the same set of pre-configured profiles on both units. Oops. Operational, geocaching, automotive, marine, fitness, and classic. And that's just to sort of change some of the presets for how the map and the menus show up and the order in which menus show when you hit the menu or cycle through them between quit and page. And they just help with depending on the type of activity that you're performing. I tend to leave mine recreational since this is mostly used for hiking and biking. But the other ones do have their merits. Geocaching obviously will make those options become a little bit more readily available. I will note that setting this to the geocaching profile still does not give you that extra menu that you get on this one during the when you're on the map and you hit the menu button. The geocaching filter option is not going to be available on this one. So that's probably the biggest difference in the UI between these two. Is that you don't get that option on this one. One thing that I wanted to talk about in terms of the performance of both units as well is, well, as you can see, they're both off a little bit on the elevation. The compass on the units, it does not matter how much I calibrate them, they're both pointing slightly different. And I tried switching between true north and magnetic north and all those things, and it just does not seem to make a huge difference. So I apologize for my super dried out fingers. I need some sort of manicure or something, but this is a technical review, so you guys are ignoring my fingers and just staring at the devices. So okay, so that one, let me set it until it points completely east. Okay, and then you'll notice that with this one, if you notice, the angles on both are different. And I cannot get them, no matter how much I calibrate both units, to be pointing exactly to the same location for, you know, the different degrees in the compass. So obviously there are discrepancies in the sensors. I'm not sure if this is correct across the line. I suppose I would need at least three units in order for me to figure out if one of them is inaccurate or they're both inaccurate. If all three tend to point in different locations. But I will say that when I set this unit, the newer one, to magnetic north, and I compare it to the compass on my phone, they seem to be pretty spot on. This one, even when I set it to magnetic north, it tends to not point exactly to the same angle. So, strange discrepancy. I'm not sure what to think of it. Obviously, this would affect things such as, you know, if you're going around doing the sight and go feature. But other than that, I guess with the GPS location, you'll still be able to correct that a little bit. When you move them around, I did notice that they tend to sort of jump around a little bit, sometimes to the point where it'll kind of freeze at a certain angle or degree. But then you move it slightly and then it just jumps quite a few degrees. So compass on either unit is not extremely accurate, and it might actually affect your bearings a little bit. So one thing to consider. And like I said, I cannot tell if it's this one or this one. I do think, though, that this unit right now is pointing closer to what east really is than this one is. And I say that because my apartment complex, it's pretty much built square, pointing north, excuse me, north-south, if you consider the true north. And this is actually pointing towards a wall that would be the east wall. And this one's pointing more towards the diagonal between that wall and the north wall. So It's one of those things that if I had three, maybe five units in front of me, I could pinpoint which one is actually being the bad boy. But for now, I just wanted to mention it and have you decide, you know, if it's kind of a deal breaker for either unit. Another thing that I wanted to mention is both of these units provide tones. They contain probably a tiny little tweeter somewhere in the inside the body. I'm not sure where the sound actually comes from, but you can definitely hear it when it's on, and it is on by default in most profiles. But one thing I wanted to show you is that on the 64ST, the tones are pretty audible. No complaints there. Let's see. Set the profile to geocache because I know that one usually has. Profile change. Studio caching. Now I'm not getting any tone at all, which is strange. Oh, the battery, of course. So, egg on my face, but if the battery level is below a certain level on either unit, then tones are not possible. But one thing I was going to show you, and well, you'll just have to take my word for it, is that tones on the 62ST are pretty muffled. In fact, not only muffled, but there's a slight, almost like a hiss that kind of follows them, versus on the 64ST where they're pretty clear and pretty audible. So I don't know if they changed the hardware around, or if I just happened to pick a unit that is slightly defective, but I do know that the tones on this one are definitely nowhere near as clear as the ones on the 64ST. I turn tones off all the way. I don't even know why you would have them on. You happen to have hardware buttons. I can see tones being necessary if you're using a touchscreen. If you're using hardware buttons, they're not as necessary. And when you're out trailing, biking, whatnot, you're probably not even going to be able to hear them over the sounds of nature and your bicycle and everything else. So for me, not a huge deal, but I did wanted to point it out. It could be new hardware, you know, better stuff. It could just be a defective unit. Who knows? But the bottom line is they are definitely different. As you can hear this one. So you can't even hear it. There's right now when I tap on any key, it's supposed to make a slight, it's like a low clicky sound. And I don't know if you can hear that. It's very faint. On this unit though, you could actually hear it pretty clear. It's more like a click, click, click. So definitely this one has some issues with the speaker. It could be the sign, it could be defective, but either way, I'm not really too big on the tones. I turn them off usually, so for me it's not a big deal. For you, it could be, so keep that in mind. Other than that, I think I've pretty much covered everything. This one obviously has more built-in memory for mapping data, so if you did not want to have to purchase a separate SD card, they're pretty cheap these days, but you might be against it, then this unit will do just fine. But you're going to be paying $500 right now for this unit. I think the retail on it is $549, and you cannot get it for anywhere near $500. I purchased it at REI, and I get the $50 back as being a member, so that's kind of a benefit. Don't know if I'm keeping it yet. I might return it. This unit at $250 or $249.99, I think is an excellent unit. My opinion between the two is that you couldn't go wrong with either one. Obviously with this one you get all the features of this one plus a few other extra things like Bluetooth and GLONASS. You do get the slightly cooler calibration on the screen, and it seems to be a little bit blurrier. And I'm gonna show you, I'm gonna zoom out. Let me go to the map and I'll try to focus here in a moment. Okay, hopefully you can see that clearly. I know I have the screen protectors on them, but they're fairly new and I've been testing them on the field, and I just want to make sure that they don't get scratched up in case I need to return one of them. But as you can see, let me, I should probably switch this back to creational. Okay, and hopefully the proper maps are chosen. I can always check that in here. Just want to make sure I don't have anything extra set up. Okay, so we got, yep. All right, so let's go back. So now that the units are pretty much in the same spot, you're gonna notice something straight away. I mean, this is like kind of an obvious one, but the contrast on the roads on this one for the specific map I have compared to this one, it's a little bit higher. You can actually not see it all that well on the video, but when you look at it in reality, this one, the contrast is a little bit lower. I think it's because the cooler color calibration causes everything to be bluish, and then they kind of almost blend. Now if I zoom out, obviously this is a topo map, so it's showing me the different levels. If I zoom out, let's see, all the way until it shows that, let's zoom out to 30 miles. Okay. And obviously don't have satellites right now, so it's blinking that question mark there, but we're pretty much in the same spot. But here we go. This is a prime example of what I'm trying to convey with the screens. So as you can see on this one, being a warmer color calibration, there's a lot of contrast between the different shaded relief features on the map. You can clearly see what's a lighter shade of green and what's kind of brownish and, you know, blue for the bodies of water, some of the roads, and the road labels are pretty much as close to pure white as they can get on this screen. On this one, everything kind of shares the same sort of bluish hue, which affects a little bit of the shading between the browns and the greens, and not too easy to see on the video because the video does its own calibration, but the actual road labels are darker looking. They have that bluish hue to them and they do look darker. Here they don't look as bad, but you can still see that it's a little bit kind of blurry. This one's look a lot crisper. Everything has a better, just a better contrast overall. I think this unit is pretty recent. It was probably, I mean, Cabela's had a shipment coming in from Garmin and I happened to pick one up. So I don't think it's a matter of this one being really old. It could be that a few of these units have this calibration on them, or this specific screen, who knows? Or it could be that the hardware specs are completely different. Maybe they're trying to save on costs or something. I prefer this one. I think for, excuse me, for any sort of trail or hiking or anything of that sort, I would appreciate more the contrast, especially in the shaded relief type of map feature. When I'm watching movies or TV or whatever, I usually tend to set my my TVs a little bit on the cooler side, but I think for the purpose of this, this is going to be the better screen, hands down. So between the two units, if they were both 64 SDs or both 62 SDs and I had purchased both of them, I'd probably return this one and see if I can get one with this screen. You know, that's just me. Your opinion may vary a little bit. But, you know, something to keep in mind. And I mean, it's I think it's actually clear even on this video that the contrast on this is much better, this unit. I have them both at the same brightness level, by the way, which is half brightness. I didn't want to get them too bright. This one right now, because of the battery issue, won't display too bright, but trust me, brand new batteries, this looks the same. Now, when the backlights are off on both of them, and the sun is hitting them straight on, they look near identical, so it could be the same screen with different calibrations. I know I've spent a lot of time on this specific topic, but seeing how this is a unit you're going to be carrying around and looking at, I think it's a big, you know, it's a big deal. This is one of those where I would definitely go with this one hands down. So another thing that I wanted to talk about, since this is a feature of this one, geocaches. This one comes preloaded with 250,000 geocaches. I think those span the U.S. and Canada. I know that definitely it has quite a few from my local area here in the Puget Sound. This one does not. I have loaded some geocaches on it for the local region. And I just wanted to show you kind of like what the interface looks like. That is slightly different on both units. It's one of those that I don't really have an opinion about. It's just for, displaying several types of information on the screen for you on the specific geocache that you open up. So, whether you like one or the other, that's going to be a preference thing. I'm not really partial to one or the other. But I'll go in here, and I'm actually going to find the same geocache on both. Just to kind of see the contrast. Naturally, because I have so many on this one that come preloaded, I'm going to have to do the whole page down thing for a couple of pages until I find the one that I'm looking for. There it goes. Okay, so this one here, and then on here, it's right there. So right off the bat, one thing you're going to notice is you're going to see a little bar here. And I believe the bar is for the size of the geocache. So that's something that on the 64ST you can see right away. So it shows you a couple of stats right here. The only thing this will show you on the list is the distance between you and the cache. Other than that, I'm not sure what this symbol signifies. I'm really new to geocache. So if this actually signifies something that is actually being displayed here numerically, I'll have to apologize for not actually knowing that offhand. I'm guessing once I do more reviews in the future, I'll be well versed on that. But anyways, let me jump right in into showing you what the geocaches look like when you open them up. So when you hit enter to select them, it'll automatically go to the map view, and I love satellite, but won't affect this specific demo. So the cursor will be on the geocache. You'll see the information banner on the top for both. It shows you the distance between you and the geocache. If you hit the menu button and review point, you can do this on both units. You will see that the information display differs a little bit in the format. I mean, they're giving you the same information, it's just slightly different. This one will show you a star rated system for the star rated system for the difficulty terrain, and then that same bar that you saw on the geocache menu list is going to be displayed here for the actual size. You'll have the description information at the bottom. On this one, I noticed that there's also a an extra field for, I'm guessing, the greatness of the cache, of the geocache. Not sure. I don't know if this is actually a rating that is done when people actually find it and they rate that, or if it's the actual person that posted the geocache. Again, I'm fairly new, so I apologize if that's something that it's obvious to some, but I just wanted to point out that that information does not show on here for the preloaded geocaches. I haven't tried loading the same geocaches that I have here, so that could be information that will be visible here. It's just that the preloaded ones don't have it. Just wanted to get that out of the way. You can still scroll down and it'll show you the actual description for the geocache. and the information is pretty much identical. So, no surprises there. Scroll all the way to the bottom just in case there's something extra that I'm missing. So here we go, it shows the logs. And on this one, I don't think the preloaded ones have, oh, they do, okay. So, they do have logs, and they're actually fairly recent. As you can see, even though I loaded this one directly from one of the geocaching sites, the last log listed here is from 2013. On this one, I actually have logs from January of this year, which is pretty amazing, seeing how this is all preloaded on the unit. So there you have it. And I'm even able to see additional ones that are not even... stops right there. So... clearly there's a bit of a discrepancy between the logs. Maybe that has to do with the different sites. Who knows? I do intend to get a little bit more into geocaching. Just haven't done it enough to be well versed on the etiquette and all the different information that gets shared when people find them. So again, this is what the interface looks like on the newer 64SD, and this is what the interface looked like on the 62SD, or looks like, since this is still being sold. So another difference that I wanted to point out has to do with the setup on both units. If you go to the system setup, which is a screen where you can select the type of GPS supported, and this one is going to be kind of an obvious one. I just wanted to show it just so you know what it looks like on the interface. But on the 64SD, you can choose between standard GPS or GPS plus GLONASS. And separately, you can enable WAS, whereas on the GPS 62ST, you have within the GPS type selection is where you choose if you want to have WAS, which I think signifies GPS plus WAS enabled. Just a slight difference between the two. This one, obviously, not supporting GLONASS, won't have that option, but they added this as an extra step here, and it just kind of makes the screen a little bit more full, I guess. Makes it seem more substantial. I suppose this is just a UI thing, and it's not really something that would denote that this one has additional features with that versus this one. But the other thing I wanted to show is under the type of battery supported, if you notice here, you can choose between alkaline, lithium, and rechargeable nickel metal hydride. I actually do not know if you can recharge, if you select rechargeable nickel metal hydride, if you can recharge it directly on the unit via the USB port on the back. I know that the USB port does power the unit. While the unit is plugged into your computer, it will power on and it will not use your battery life, but I do not know if you can actually charge it directly on the unit. On this one, if you go to that option, you have the same options, except this two are sort of separated. And this one says traditional nickel metal hydride, and this one says precharged. Since I don't know that much about batteries, I'm not sure if it is that you can actually purchase this type of batteries already precharged. Maybe that's what it means. Don't know what the difference would be between the two, if the batteries are the same type and they use the same amperage rating. Then I don't know what difference this would make, but I wanted to show you so you knew that there was an additional option there. Maybe one of you could enlighten me and post a comment stating what this would do if you chose one or the other option between the two. It definitely adds a little bit of complexity. If you had the batteries, you know, might have to figure out which is the correct option. And of course, I've got alkaline batteries on right now, so that's the option that I choose on both. On this one, battery is actually pretty low, and the unit will not allow brightness level to be set to the highest. I mean, you can do it, but it's not going to actually do it. And as you can see, the GPS signal on it, this is indoors. I am about 2 feet away from the window. There's blinds, and you still get a pretty good strength from the satellite signals. And this one, not so good. So, if you have this paired to a phone and you have notifications enabled, it will show an additional option down here. If you hit the power button and then you hit the menu button, you can view notifications. So that's one thing that I wanted to point out. I don't have this paired with my phone at the moment, but if I did, it would work. Let's see if I can show you this quickly. I can't remember if I left the pairing or if I disabled it. Oh, there it goes. So you see the Bluetooth option showing you that it's on, and then it shows you that additional option to view notifications. Oops. Apologies. No notifications. And this will be that way for eternity, because I do not have an iOS device to test on at the moment. My iPhone is no longer usable. So one last thing that I wanted to mention, and this one is pretty much impossible to show you during the day, and I don't happen to have a dark enough room to be able to show you that, but both units have backlit keys on the keypads. The main difference I found, though, is that on the 64ST, they are so dim, it almost looks like they're not backlit. If the room is completely dark, you can see them, but they're extremely, extremely dim. On the 62ST, they're a little bit brighter, and you can actually notice them right away as soon as it gets slightly dark. So much easier to actually read the text. If you've been using the units for a while, you don't really need to be reading the text. You kind of know your fingers fall on the right places. So this one's not a humongous deal, but it's another point knocked out for this one in terms of the display and the backlit on the keys. They seem dimmer. They do not change with the situation with the battery limitations when the battery is low. On a brand new battery set all the way to the highest setting, this is still not as readable as this is when it's dark. So it's another thing I wanted to point out. These points that I'm trying to make are because I've seen a movement in the electronics industry where oftentimes when you've got two pieces of hardware, one supposed to be the improved version, in reality what it seems to be is they're actually pushing for cost reduction. And I noticed that right off the bat, as soon as this unit was available, the MSRP on it was, or at least the street price on it, was much lower than when this unit first came out. Now, mind you, this was about 4 years ago, and it's possible that the hardware was simply more expensive back then, regardless of it being equal. But I tend to be a little bit more cynical about it, and I really believe that they did something with the specifications on the screen on this, as well as perhaps the the backlighting on the keys. Physically, they feel identical. I don't feel any squeakiness on one over the other. I don't feel that the keys are softer or harder on one than the other. They feel exactly the same. If I put a black tape over this to cover the model number, you would not be able to tell these units apart. They're that identical. Weight, feel, layout of the keys, the feel of the keys, and other than the bluish tint hue, both screens pretty much identical. So if you were to decide to get one unit over the other, can't go wrong. If you have the $500 to spare and you want the extra features, Bluetooth connectivity for the live track and the notifications if you happen to have an iPhone, this is the unit to go. If you want the convenience of already having enough built-in memory for all your custom apps, this is the way to go. If you don't mind spending the extra $6-$7 for a microSD card and getting all your custom maps in, this unit will do just as well. You do get the 250,000 geocaches preloaded on this. You don't get any on here. You have to preload them yourself. Geocaches do not consume that much space, so it's not going to be anything that's going to degrade the functionality of this by virtue of occupying too much space. They both support bird's eye view maps. This one comes with a 1-year subscription. Right now, if you go to the Garmin website, you can get a 1-year subscription for any device. Well, it'll be bound to a specific device, but I'm just saying it'll work with any of the units that support it for $29.99. So $30 a year, that's something extra here. So you've got the extra memory on this, Bluetooth functionality. You've got the 1-year subscription for the bird's eye imagery. Extra RAM. I think I already mentioned that. But you do get some additional features for this. Is that worth $250 over this one at the current street price on this? I honestly don't think so. I think that for $250, you could just get two of these and then just hand one over as a Christmas present to somebody, or just, you know, if you're going hiking with your buddies, you could just have one of them use one and, you know, I don't know, maybe you guys can compete for finding a geocache or something. But I can think of better ways to put $250 to use than just to purchase Bluetooth functionality that I will very seldom use, if at all. Additional memory that is completely feasible on this with micro SD cards, and the slight performance edge that you get on this. I think this is the way to go. If you can find this unit brand new for $250, my opinion is, and my vote goes to the Garmin GPSMAP 62ST. Feel free to post your opinions. This is actually my first video review of any kind, so I hope to be able to improve over time, and hopefully this specific review gave you the information you need to make a decision between the two devices. Thank you, and hope you enjoy it.